Intermittent fasting is incredibly popular. People report weight loss, improved glucose metabolism, lower cholesterol, the works. But are those results just a consequence of eating less calories overall? Or is there a specific benefit to fasting? In other words, if I just eat a little bit less every day, is that just as good as fasting? Or does fasting itself deliver some special metabolic benefit? Many of the podcasts and popular books out there will promise all kinds of specific benefits to fasting. They'll tell you that there is something special about it, something evolutionary, the wonderful benefits of autophagy, and therefore that we should all fast to get those benefits, and if we don't, we're leaving gains on the table. Now, we made a whole video on intermittent fasting a while back, and in preparation for that, I went over all the existing literature at the time. This was like 2 years ago, and what I found was that in studies that match for calories, intermittent fasting didn't seem any better than just eating a little bit less calories daily without fasting. So who's right after all? What's the truth? Well, recently a new study came out trying to settle precisely this question, and it was designed in a very smart way. First, they watched the volunteers for 4 weeks and recorded everything they ate, just their normal baseline diet. Then they took some of the volunteers and they asked them to start fasting. And they use what's called alternate day fasting, or ADF. Basically, you fast one day, you don't eat anything, you can drink water or non-caloric drinks. Next day, you can eat whatever you want. The day after that, you fast again, and so on. But on the eating days, they asked them to eat exactly double their normal baseline intake. That way, they're fasting 50% of the time every other day, so it's substantial, but there's no overall caloric deficit. They're still eating the same total number of calories they were eating before. So if fasting delivers some special benefit aside from calories, we should see it in this group. But if it's all about calories, there should be no change. And what they found was that this group didn't lose any weight, didn't lose any fat mass, and their metabolic parameters also stayed the same. All right, but eating twice as much every other day is pretty intense. That's a lot of stuffing yourself. People fasting probably will compensate a bit on the eating days, but maybe not that much. So they did another experiment. They asked another group to start fasting, ADF, alternate day fasting, every other day, but they asked them to eat 150% of normal on the eating days. So a bit more than normal, but not enough to completely compensate for the fasting. So they're still getting less calories than at baseline. They're eating 75% of normal baseline intake, right? Zero on the fasting days, 150 on the eating days averaged out, 75. Right? So they're cutting back 25% of calories, which is pretty substantial. And they compared this group to another group that started eating 25% less calories every day without fasting, other than, you know, sleep. So both groups eating 25% less calories than at baseline, but one is fasting, one is not. If fasting is something special, we should see an advantage of the fasting group. If it's all about calories, they should look about the same. And they found that both groups lost some weight. Not surprising, they're both eating less than before. And the amount was about the same. No significant difference. So again, at face value, suggesting that it's mostly about the calories, not fasting per se. But then they looked beyond just weight loss, because nobody wants to lose weight. What we want to lose is fat, extra fat mass. So the group eating a little bit less every day without fasting, almost all the weight they lost was fat mass, which is good. But the intermittent fasting group, only half the weight they lost was fat. The other half was lean mass. So this result indicated that in these conditions, the fasting protocol actually inhibited fat loss. As the researchers state, alternate day fasting less effectively reduces body fat than matched energy restriction, without evidence of fasting-specific effects on metabolic regulation or cardiovascular health. Now, why would they lose less fat if they're eating the same total amount of calories? Well, they found that the fasted group that was on 75% of calories had less physical activity overall. This isn't exercise, it's just general physical activity, like moving around or general body movement. That got reduced in that group. The investigators speculate that there's a subconscious process reducing spontaneous movement in those conditions of fasting coupled with some caloric restriction and weight loss. So that's not an absolute limitation of fasting. We could just make sure to include more physical activity, like, for example, exercise more, or even just move around more. In their own words, the main practical message for individuals to consider if planning to use alternate day fasting is to consciously insert opportunities for physical activity. So, should be possible to work around it. We'll come back to this in a second, and to that issue of the loss of lean mass, but this was the gist of the study. It was a very flashy study, it got a lot of press, but we always want to be cautious with isolated studies. Maybe there was something about the conditions that make it an outlier. So we always want to ask, is this reflective of all the available evidence? With regard to intermittent fasting not providing a special benefit beyond calories, yes. For example, this meta-analysis looked at 11 trials comparing intermittent fasting to continuous energy restriction. So basically just eating a little bit less every day, but not fasting per se. And it found no apparent superiority of a dietary regimen. So intermittent fasting was fine, there was weight loss, but it was identical to eating a little bit less every day. Another meta-analysis looked at 6 trials, and it found that intermittent fasting was comparable to continuous energy restriction for short-term weight loss in overweight and obese adults, and duration of the studies was 3 to 12 months. And this review of the field concludes, the efficacy of intermittent fasting appears broadly equivalent to standard daily energy restriction. And the results for other metabolic parameters, like changes in glucose metabolism or blood lipids, also follow this trend, because they usually track with overall caloric intake and weight loss. Now, here's an interesting tidbit. On occasion, I've seen isolated studies shared online as evidence that intermittent fasting does provide a specific independent benefit. For example, this randomized control trial from 2019. They had one group on intermittent fasting and another continuously eating less, and they did try to match for calories. And they report that the intermittent fasting group showed greater reductions in weight, fat mass, cholesterol, etc. So it sounds really impressive, and I've even seen this study mentioned in reviews as an outlier, as an example of a study where intermittent fasting did deliver some benefits above and beyond just calories. But when I dug into the details, when I read it carefully, it does show the estimated caloric intake, and the intermittent fasting group did end up eating significantly less calories. So this study actually turns out not to be an exception. It's actually totally aligned with the idea that caloric intake explains the differences. So just a little aside that this is very common. There's a study that seems to be an exception and clashes with everything, and maybe everything we thought we knew was wrong. And then you look into the details, and not only is there no contradiction, but the odd study actually ends up perfectly aligning with everything we know. Very common. And there are some other studies like that in the literature and some meta-analyses that show better results on intermittent fasting when calories are not matched or when the caloric intake is not reported. One example is the Matador trial, which had a really interesting design and found more weight loss on intermittent fasting, but unfortunately they don't report actual caloric intake, so it's hard to draw a firm conclusion. Okay, what about that loss of lean mass on intermittent fasting? Is that a concern? The first thing to say is that lean mass isn't necessarily muscle. It can be, but it could also be water or glycogen. Most of these studies don't really differentiate. The second thing is that the loss of lean mass didn't reach statistical significance in the recent study we just looked at. There was a lot of variation, so it didn't pass statistical tests. But there are some meta-analyses, like this one, for example, that do find a significant reduction in lean mass on alternate day fasting. But I've also seen several others that don't show a reduction in lean mass. So it's not consistent. It depends on the specific conditions. So this is something to bear in mind for people doing intermittent fasting, especially the longer forms, like 24 hours like in ADF, or even longer. Now, there are some potential strategies to get around it, because that's what we do here. We bring solutions to the table. So one solution to retain muscle mass while fasting is resistance training, basically weightlifting or just challenging your muscles somehow. In fact, a systematic review indicates this might work. Fasting paired with resistance training generally maintained lean body mass. So that's good news. Another thing that may help is making sure that we get adequate protein intake. Fasting can mean less calories, which can mean less protein sometimes, so we want to make sure we get enough. And yet another strategy is to have some food on the off days. Instead of being 100% fast, having a couple hundred calories on those days and making it a protein-rich food to give your muscles that anabolic signal. So what's the bottom line here? Does intermittent fasting work? Well, it depends what we mean by work. If we mean, can it help with weight loss? Absolutely. That's been shown many times. Is it going to work for every single person? No. But it can work. It's an option on the table. Now, if by work we mean a special benefit that only fasting can give you, like the marketing often implies, then the answer is probably not. The available evidence is pretty consistent that you get the same benefits whether you eat a little bit less every day or you stop eating for longer chunks of time. When you match for calories, they look pretty similar. So whatever works for you. And by the way, I wish it was special. I wish it was some magic ancestral switch. Out of all the internet dietary trends I've seen, this is probably my favorite. It doesn't involve anything crazy. It doesn't involve eating any unhealthy foods. It's simple. It's free. You don't have to pay anybody. You just stop eating. I love it. They basically found a way to get Westerners to eat a little bit less. I'm all about it. And if the evidence changes tomorrow and we find a specific way to do it that does deliver a special benefit you can't get anywhere else, and we start seeing study after study and meta-analyses convincingly showing it, I'll make a video about it the same day. And I'll start fasting. Duh. Until then, it's another option on the table for people who like it. A valid option among many. And in fact, this is how it's usually described in the medical literature. Intermittent fasting is a valid, but not superior, alternative to caloric restriction. The language is dispassionate when they're objectively looking at the data. They're not trying to sell you anything. Another way to look at it is that intermittent fasting may provide an alternative approach for individuals who struggle with daily energy restriction. So, option on the table for those who prefer it. Great. Now, in terms of individual variability, as we said earlier, in some studies where calories aren't matched or intake isn't reported, we sometimes do see intermittent fasting work better. People often don't eat enough on the on days to completely compensate for the fast, so they end up being overall calorically restricted and losing weight. And that's good. That's what most people want. But in some other studies, we don't see that, and fasting does not lead to any weight loss. For example, this meta-analysis looked at 8 intermittent fasting studies and found body fat was reduced in 5 of those 8. So it depends how we do it, just like everything else. So if you figured out a setup that works for you, phenomenal. In fact, share it below, might help other people. Yeah, it's anecdotal, but maybe it'll work for some others as well. It's the same for all of these approaches. Low fat, low carb, low calorie, intermittent fasting, they can all work for some people. And then there's always some other people who don't do well in each one of those, which is why it's great that we have all of these possibilities. If one thing doesn't work for you, try something else. What we have to be careful about is the marketing hype and the sales pitch that some guy figured out the hidden secrets of weight loss. Nope, he didn't. And this religious fanaticism that the thing that worked for me is special and it has to work for everybody else. And if it doesn't work for you, then you're doing something wrong. Sometimes people get offended because this thing that saved their life, we're saying it's just like the others. It feels like a personal attack. But we're not taking anything away from your experience. If it worked for you, just stick with it. There's no need to extrapolate and make these sweeping claims. That requires robust scientific evidence. Now, often the hype has a nugget of truth. With intermittent fasting, a lot of it is based on animal research. Because in mice, fasting does provide special benefits beyond calories. And a lot of the internet messaging piggybacks on that and suggests it translates to humans. A lot of this excitement around autophagy, for example, comes straight from animal research. But it's pointless to speculate if intermittent fasting delivers benefits through autophagy or this gene or that biochemical pathway if the human trials don't show a specific benefit in the first place. It's all superseded by human trials, and those keep showing that when we measure caloric intake and account for it, intermittent fasting doesn't offer any independent benefits on top of cutting calories. If new data comes tomorrow, phenomenal. But right now, this is where we're at. These investigators spell it out. The hypothesized benefits of intermittent fasting, extensively studied in animal models, include preferential reduction of adipose mass, increased insulin sensitivity, reduced inflammation, autophagy, apoptosis. They might all be possible, and many of these have been demonstrated in animal models, but not in humans. So, unlike the very promising data in animals, the evidence is not sufficiently robust to suggest superiority of intermittent fasting when compared to continuous caloric restriction on cardiovascular factors in humans. So throwing sciencey words at the public is great to sell books, it's great to sound smart, but when it comes to actionable advice, stuff that people can implement and get results, who cares about autophagy? Are you going to go into your kitchen and activate autophagy? Would it cause net harm or benefit? We have no idea. So this is a complete distraction. We focus on things that are actionable and shown to work reproducibly in humans. It's fine to speculate out of academic interest and talk about basic research. I mean, nerd power all day long. I love it. But the logic leap that we should all go do something because it worked in rats, that's not compelling. So just learn to spot that pattern. It's usually a big red flag. These guys go even further. Bluntly, the number of diet books advising how intermittent fasting can be incorporated into our lives is several orders of magnitude greater than the number of scientific papers examining whether intermittent fasting should be encouraged at all. That's a perfect description of hype. All right, last thing to say is that there is a difference between fasting and meal timing, what time of day you eat. Unlike fasting, meal timing does seem to deliver some specific benefits beyond just calories. And we covered all of that here. And here's our first video on intermittent fasting from a while back for some more background information. Take care, see you next time. All the fasting talk made me hungry. Before she ever would say.